Hey, what's up guys, and welcome to another video. So today's video is going to be about a laptop. So my last video that I filmed back in August was about a Dell, a Lenovo ThinkPad L430 that I sold to a friend of mine. I repaired it for them and I sold it to a friend of mine that I work with. In that video, I mentioned that I also had a new laptop of my own that I had, replaced my ThinkPad T420 with. And so that's what today's video is going to be about. Today's video is going to be about the new laptop that I've replaced my venerable ThinkPad with. So this computer, if you can't read the title, is something that, something that you wouldn't expect me to own. It's a bit different than what I would normally have. It's something that you wouldn't expect me to buy, but I bought it, and it's something that I do own, and I've been using it for about a year and a half now. So without further ado, let's go ahead and take a look at it. Here it is. And yes, that's not a joke. That is an Apple logo. Yes, this thing is a MacBook.
Apple's shit. Overpriced garbage for trendy hipsters. Oh. We're going to delve into the colon.
And you're probably thinking, why? Aren't you, like, anti-Apple? Well, no, not really. I used to be. I've never really been anti-Apple. I've just been anti-bullshit. And, Apple is still kind of bullshit, but I've gotten to kind of like some of their stuff recently. Of course, I've had my iPhone for nearly 2 years now, and I really like it. Also in 2018, I also got this. So this laptop is a 2016 MacBook Pro, or what I like to call the DongleBook. It is the first USB-C MacBook Pro. As you can see, if I show you here, it is the USB-C one, the 2016, the first generation of the USB-C MacBook Pros. And so this machine, I didn't exactly want to buy one of these, but it sort of happened. I was in the market for a laptop, of course. I sold my T420. In fact, I traded it actually to my dad. So the T420 is still in my residence. Is just not my computer anymore, it's my father's now. And that computer is still going very well. It's running very well for what it is. It needs some replacement parts now. It needs a new keyboard, apparently, and a battery, but other than that, it's, generally still running pretty well. But how did I come across this thing? Well, first of all, this computer, so this was sold to me by a former lecturer of mine that I went to TAFE with. So someone that actually taught me at TAFE, was using this, and I was doing some computer work for them back in July of 2018. So shortly after I actually took my hiatus on YouTube, I actually got this computer. So this I got in July of 2018. So the deal is that I was looking for a new laptop, and so I was doing this work for this person. They had recently bought an iMac. A 2018, I think, iMac, or whatever the latest iMac was. At the time, it wasn't an iMac Pro, just a standard iMac. Fairly nice one at that. Whatever high-end i7 was out in 2018, or whatever the latest iMac, I think. It might have been a Kaby Lake, actually, a 7th gen i7 with, 32 gigs of RAM. So it was pretty nice. And so they were replacing this MacBook with it. They never used the laptop. They actually had a smaller 12-inch MacBook that they used as a laptop, and she didn't need this big 15-inch one anymore. And so she knew I was in the market for a laptop, and she said, because I was doing some data recovery for her, I was getting the data off this machine, as well as she had a few other computers. She wanted to consolidate all her data. She had a few other older machines, and she wanted all of that data basically consolidated into one platform. She couldn't, she didn't want to do it herself. So she, hired me to do it. And so she knew I was in the market for a laptop, and she said, "Look, I'm getting rid of this MacBook, and you need a laptop." And I was talking to her about what I sort of wanted. I was thinking to myself that I would buy a used MacBook Air, before the 2018 one. I was thinking of buying a 2014 or 15 MacBook Air, because that's kind of what I wanted. I wanted to get into Mac OS X. Because I've been using iOS for a little bit on my iPhone, and I started to really like it. And, I'm not going to replace my desktop platform, which is Windows, I sort of wanted to get into the Mac just to, you know, have a modern Macintosh. That's really what I wanted. And I was tossing up other options too. I mean, I was looking at some other ultrabooks and just some smaller, you know, machines. I wanted something a bit smaller than my T420, actually. Something that was smaller and lighter and just thin and light. Something that I could just throw in a backpack and not have to worry about. And something that would get really decent battery life. Just be better overall than my, you know, fairly chunky at that point T420. Which was basically a 7-year-old laptop at that point. So she said, okay, well, I'm selling this MacBook. You know, I've just got this iMac and I have my little 12-inch. You know, do you want it? And I was just like, yeah, but that's going to cost... I was just like, well, how much do you want for it? She originally wanted about $1,400, I think. But I had done, you know, a fair few hours work for her at this point. And so she was just like, well... What we can do is I'll take a few hundred dollars off the computer as your pay, and then you can just pay me for the computer, and then, you know, just pay a discounted price for the computer, and then, you know, the money I owe you for the job, I would take it out of the computer for you. And so that's what she did. So I got this 2016, so this is in 2018, so this computer was only 2 years old, basically, I think about 2 years old at the oldest. I think this one is a 27. I think this one was manufactured in 2017, even. So this one is a 2-year-old computer, basically, at that point. $900 is what I paid for this. $900. It didn't come with this clear case. It actually had a black plastic case on it, which we'll get to later. But $900 dues for this MacBook Pro.
$900 dues? Tobias! Did you accept a 6-hour collect call from the States?
It was an emergency call from the International Drainage Commission in Springfield.
Oh my God! There's nothing wrong with the bidet, is there?
Now, in 2018, one of these were still going for... I mean, this computer is not the base model either. This one, actually, I looked on Apple's website, would have cost about $3,000, maybe $4,000. And market values at the time for the 2016s... were about $2,000 or thereabouts for a 15-inch 2016 MacBook in this config. Or even the slower ones. This is not base model either. Even the slower ones were, around about $2,000. I got it for $900, less than half. Even though it's a Mac and, you know, they're generally pretty expensive and it's still $900, it's still a lot of money. I think for what this computer was worth at the time and probably still worth now even, 2 years later, about a year and a half later since I bought it. You know, I think that's not a bad deal. I mean, you can call me an idiot in the comments all you like, but, you know, I think I got, you know, a pretty decent deal on this computer. Now, I mentioned how I got it without this plastic shell on it. As you can see, it's got this clear plastic case. I put this on. Originally, it had a black plastic case on it. And I've got some photos of when I first got it with the black plastic case on there. I kept that case on for a little while, but it wasn't the greatest. I could already see some stress cracks in it, mostly around the hinge, actually, and around the corners. The case, after about a month or so, started to flake off. Like, the corners would actually flake off. So I remember for a while, I was running it. I had it for about 2 months with the black case on it. Around about a month after I got it, though, it started to deteriorate. So the plastic corners the corners of the case started to come off, and it was just really looking kind of ugly. I liked the look of it, the black, because I always liked the look of the black MacBooks, but I mean, and it sort of was incognito because you couldn't even see the Apple logo in there as well. But I was just like, yeah, this is terrible. So I actually went and found a nice clear case. And this one's been on here since, maybe August, September of 2018. And it's held up really well. Bottom is really nice. It's actually got these nice rubber feet. Now, the reason why I wanted a case on this thing is, one, to prevent dents, and two, to prevent scratches as well. But third, the most important reason was the feet. So the bottom feet on these MacBooks are just plastic. These on the case here, it's rubber, but the computer itself just has plastic feet. It slides around everywhere. It's really annoying. So I wanted this case, and the black plastic cases on here had the same problem. I didn't have rubber feet on it. This one does have rubber feet. And so this one, the computer will actually stay on a desk like a normal laptop. But yes, it's a clear plastic case. As you can see, it is not new. I mean, I bought it new, but like, it's scratched up a bit. I have been taking this in and out of a backpack for the last year and a half. But yes, that is the MacBook. So that's the case. So what are the specs of this thing? Well, this has a Intel Core i7 6820 HQ, which is a 2.7 GHz quad-core processor, so it's a Skylake CPU, 6th generation. It is quad-core hyper-threaded 2.7 GHz, and I think it's 3.2 GHz base. It has 16 GB of RAM. That's DDR3L. Now, the funny thing about the RAM is, when these were new, Apple was lambasted for not using, they were lambasted for having 16 gigs as the highest option, even on a $4,000 fucking computer, which I think was ridiculous, and I laughed at that thing when it was new. 16 gigs is plenty for me, but for a laptop, especially because it's not my primary computer. Well, I mean, at the moment it actually is, because this thing isn't working. But yes, the reason, though, these only had 16 gigs of RAM, and they only bumped it up to 32 as the max option with the 2018 MacBooks. The reason these only have 16 gigs is because Apple blamed power consumption. And the reason was because they were using DDR3L. Now, eventually they did switch to DDR4, and I'm guessing it didn't make shit all of a difference, but for some reason they used DDR3L. I guess they couldn't engineer it properly to use DDR4. Fucked if I know. But, like, RAM power consumption shouldn't make shit all of a difference. So they really should have just used 32 gig from the get-go, but it does use DDR3 RAM. It is, I think, 2133 megahertz DDR3L. So it is fast DDR3, but still DDR3. That RAM is soldered on, by the way. Something that's going to be a recurring theme of this computer. For storage, we have a 512 gig NVMe SSD. Once again, that is soldered onto the motherboard, but it is a NVMe drive. It is a custom Apple drive, of course, soldered onto the board. It is quick, though. I'm not gonna lie, it's quick. It is faster than my desktop. My desktop with a SATA SSD feels slow in comparison to this. I mean, and this is not slow, but compared to maybe it's the crusty old Windows install that's on my desktop here, but as well that might contribute. But it's not slow, but the MacBook here makes, like, this thing just annihilates it in disk performance. A SATA SSD, NVMe drives are nice. And in fact, I did actually, I'll show you, part of my next video is going to be installing one of these on that, so stay tuned for that. But yes, 512GB SSD, soldered on. Now you may be thinking, if the drive fails, how are you going to do data recovery? Well, good question. Now, these 2016 and I believe the 2017 MacBooks, the Kaby Lake versions, they have a little port on the motherboard for an Apple Tech. To be able to for the Apple Store to plug in a or an independent, if you know, to support people like Lewis Rossman. I think they'll have a little port on there which you can do data recovery with. I believe the 2018 and newer ones do not have that. And data recovery on a 2018 or newer MacBook, I believe apparently is impossible. Although my information may be out of date, I don't keep up with that stuff that much these days, but last I heard, I think the 2018 and newer ones, including the new 2019, you know, one with the fixed keyboard, those don't have a port to do data recovery. I think it's all locked out by the T2 chip. This predates the T2 chip, but this has the T1, predates T2 as far as I know. But yes, you can do data recovery if you need to, but if the board is fucked, then I guess you're shit out of luck. I still wish they did replaceable SSDs. Like, the RAM, yeah, soldered RAM sucks, but, you know, I could deal with that. Soldered SSD, I mean, I wouldn't, no. I don't like that at all. As for graphics, what does this thing have? So this thing has the Intel integrated, the Intel integrated HD 630, I think, or 620 or something, or I think it's 630, it's what built into the CPU. It also has an AMD Radeon Pro 455. So it's part of the Radeon Polaris family, so it is basically a Radeon, I mean, they call it Radeon Pro. It is just essentially just a Radeon RX mobile card. They just use the Pro drivers. I don't think the Pro cards are any different than the normal AMD stuff, although correct me if I'm wrong. But yeah, it is a Radeon Pro 455. It's not the highest in graphics option, which makes me think that this computer was a custom-to-order machine because it's got the higher-end SSD, but it's got the lower-end graphics. Because these also came with a Radeon Pro 460. Because this has the higher tier CPU, as well as the higher tier SSD, as well as but the lower end graphics. It has 2 GB of VRAM. Now, this is, of course, this is not a gaming machine. I do have GTA 5 installed on here, but to be honest, I've never actually played it. So I actually don't know how games run, and I've had the thing for 18 months, but I don't need it as a gaming computer. Look at all this. I have several game consoles and a gaming PC. So, you know, this is not a gaming computer, but I guess if I wanted to play GTA 5, I guess I could. I mean, I guess it could run. I've run it on less. Of course, this is the 15-inch. It has the 15-inch Retina display. And let's have a look around the computer. What else do we have here? So, we'll just go around the ports, and there's not going to be that many of them. So, for port selection, we have 2 Thunderbolt 3 ports, which use the USB Type-C connector, and a headphone jack. And ironically, this came out at the same time as the iPhone 7 removing the headphone jack, but if they removed the headphone jack off of a MacBook, that would be asinine. I mean, it was asinine on the phone at the time, but I guess we've all gotten over it now, haven't we? And on the other side, we have two more Thunderbolt 3 ports, which use the USB Type-C connector. Now, what is I.O. like on this machine? Well, a lot of people lambasted this thing when it was new because it only had 4 Thunderbolt 3 ports and a headphone jack. They're also going to say, where's my Ethernet? Where's my USB Type-A? Where's this? Where's that? I agree. At first, it was kind of a pain in the ass. But as I've gotten to like this computer more, I still didn't like it when I first got it, but I've kind of grown to like it, actually, and I'll explain why in a minute. But as I've grown to like this computer, I've sort of bought into the dongle life, and this is where it gets the name DongleBook from. So, because it uses USB Type-C for everything, so unless if you rebuy everything you have, you're going to be using dongles. Which is where this comes in. So this is what I call the Super Dongle. This is basically, it's basically a USB Type-C hub. I call it my Super Dongle. This cost me $40. But it has every single, I want to basically replicate my T420 in one package, and this does that. So, almost. I mean, there's a couple of ports of T420 had, which I never used anyways, so. This has, in fact, this is better, because it has some ports of T420 didn't have. So this thing has 3 USB Type-A, 3 USB Type-A ports, full-size card reader, micro SD card reader, which is awesome, because this camcorder I'm using right now uses micro SD cards, so that's nice. Normally, when I connect to the card reader on this computer, I have to use an adapter. So, that's nice, this thing has micro SD cards. It can take micro SD cards. The back, we have an Ethernet port, which I believe is gigabit, and the controller is within this. VGA port. Doesn't have the screws, which would trigger the shit out of Elmal 3. It kind of annoys me too, to be honest. We also have HDMI, two more USB 3.0 ports, as well as a USB Type-C pass-through port, which is nice. So, even if you have this plugged in, you're not going to be losing out on another Type-C port. In fact, you could probably charge the computer through that. In fact, you can. I wouldn't recommend that. Plugging the charger into this and then listen to the computer. Technically, you can do it. I wouldn't recommend it, though. But this all just connects through one Type-C connector. Now, it's the bolt. This is just USB Type-C. So if you can use this on a computer that does not have Thunderbolt 3, if it's just a USB Type-C device, you can use it. Oh, I forgot to mention this side, because I never use this one. It has a headphone jack on there too. So you can plug this into any USB Type-C device that doesn't have to be Thunderbolt compliant. Like my desktop here has a Type-C port on the back. This works on it just fine. Not that I need it on a desktop, but I wanted to test that out. But it just takes up one USB Type-C port. Now, that does look a bit ridiculous, having this big old thing hanging off here. And it's not as convenient as just having the ports built in, but at least I'm not carrying around a mess of adapters. I just have one adapter for everything I need. Of course, I do have some other Type-C stuff. I did buy a bunch of little Type-C, Type-A to Type-C adapters. I bought about 4 or 5 of them for like $1 each off of eBay when I first got the computer, just to help me transition to it. I do still have those around for, like, I think I have an older USB hub that has that on there, as well as I have some of those just for some other peripherals. I've bought a few other things. I needed a new USB flash drive, and so I saw some drives a friend of mine had that had a Type-C and a Type-A connector, so I figured I'd buy one myself, because I do a lot of data transfer between computers, so I like to have one that's got a Type-A port here. But if I flick the little switch, has a Type-C port on there as well. So, I've done this so many times now. I've had this drive for, 3 weeks, and I've used it so much. You know, if I'm transferring files from this computer, I can just pull out the Type-A, plug it in. Once I'm done, close it up, put the Type-C out, plug it in here. I don't need adapters. This is a 128 gig SanDisk Ultra USB 3 flash drive. I needed a USB 3 flash drive. I was starting to get sick of my old 64 gig USB 2.0 drive I carry around. So this is USB 3, as well as Type-C and Type-A, and it's 128 gigs. It's more double the capacity as well. But yes, so Type-C accessories. I don't really need any more at this point. I've got enough. If I need to plug into a projector, I can just plug this in. I don't need any other adapters. This has Ethernet on it as well. This has really everything I need, to be honest. So I'm not really carrying that many dongles. But Type-C is becoming the standard. It is much better than it was in 2016, when this thing first came out. That you can get a lot more Type-C stuff now for cheap. And so it's not bad to have Type-C, it's just, you still are living the dongle life if you have a lot of legacy stuff, which I do. Like, for example, if I wanted to connect an optical drive to this thing, like where am I going to find a Type-C optical drive, right? Why would they make, I mean, I'm sure there probably is one you can find, but I already have an external optical drive that's ancient, it's like 10 years old, it still works, I don't need a new one. So it's Type-A, of course, so I'm going to have to, you know, use that. But, like, I don't think I've ever used an optical drive on this thing once. As for power, now, you may have realized, well, older MacBooks had MagSafe, and these newer ones don't, so that's worse. Yes, it is. I agree. I liked MagSafe. I like that type of connector. I have an old Surface Pro that also uses a magnetic connector like that. However, what I like about this computer, this computer also uses USB Type-C to charge. Now, this goes down to my charger on the floor. What I like, though, is you can plug it into any port and it will charge. So, you can plug it in this side. There we are, you just heard the bong there, it charges. If I unplug that, I can plug it into this side as well, on one of these ports. There we are, now it's charging. It's really convenient being able to charge it. So, most of the time I plug it in on this side, because this computer just sits in the middle of my desk here when I'm using it. On this side of the desk is where I actually use this computer if I'm at home. I may have it plugged in like that, but if I need to move this out of the way to have some desk room, I quickly just unplug it, shove it over there, plug it in the other side. I don't have to move the cable around. That's nice. Or if I'm in a situation where the cord being on a particular side matters, I don't have to wrap the cord around or do this other shit. You just plug it in the side you want. It's nice. Other than that, that's really it. I mean, so there's no point in opening up the computer as well. Because for a few reasons. One, I don't have the right tools. These, if you can see, require Apple's Pentalobe bit. Now, I don't know if you can see in the reflection from my light there, but that's what that screw looks like. I think that's Apple's Pentalobe bit there, if I can get my camera to focus on it. There we are. So that's some proprietary shit screw that Apple used so that people can't get in them. There's toolkits for that. You know, you see them sponsored all the time, the iFixit kits, they can get into these things. I'm sure you can buy knockoff tools that will as well, but other than that, so there's no point getting in this thing. Soldered CPU, soldered RAM, soldered SSD, soldered nutsack, it's got the soldered everything, right? One particular con about this case while I'm here, I mean, I've noticed this start to happen. This never happened, so I've had this case for about a year and a half on here. I've noticed the rubber feet start to shift. They start moving. Especially these back ones. I guess maybe it's just wear, but I've noticed one of them was shifted like halfway across where it normally goes there a few days ago. Let's have a look inside the computer here. So you can see on the front here, all we do is just have this little latch here. You can open these things just with like your pinky if you want. In fact, that's exactly what I'm going to do just to show you. And they're perfectly weighted. Beautiful. So here is the inside of this thing. Now, my desktop's a little messy. I've actually been using this as my primary computer for a little bit, for about a week and a bit now. My desktop's Windows install shit itself. For whatever reason, I've got no keyboard input. It just has a driver problem with the keyboard. Reinstalling a driver doesn't fucking work. Just, my keyboard's fine because it works in the BIOS. So this thing needs to be blown away. Windows has just fucked itself apparently, so. So I've been using this as my primary computer for a few days. I don't mind macOS, I actually kind of like it, and I've gotten used to it over the last year and a half. It came with High Sierra when I first got it. So back to the computer though. So we have the 15.4 inch Retina display. Now this has actually just been replaced by the new 16 inch MacBook Pro, which basically has the same form factor as this, but smaller bezels. They kind of gave it the iPhone 10 treatment. But yeah, so it has, but honestly, I haven't looked at the 16 inch MacBook Pro yet. I haven't seen one yet. Next time I go to the Apple store, I guess I'll check them out, because I really want to check out the new keyboard, which we'll get to in a minute. But the new display, I mean, this display is excellent, to be honest. It's actually really nice. It's 2880 by 1800 Retina display. It looks super sharp. This is the default scaling, which I actually kind of like, but you can scale it down or up, so you can make things really small at its native res, or you can scale them to be basically the equivalent of 1680 by 1050, which is what I've got it at. To be honest, macOS probably the scaling the best out of any operating system on the market. Apple know how to do it properly. Windows scaling fucking sucks. And I've heard Linux scaling isn't the best, to be honest, either. macOS does it relatively well. I haven't encountered any issues with it. Because I'm guessing, you know, they learned how to do it from iOS with the iPhone 4 and all the Retina displays. They've been doing the Retina displays for a while now, and honestly, they're really nice. This one's really good, although I've noticed it does have some weird color spots in the middle. You can't see it on this background, but if I open something that's white, let me open text edit. Oh, wait, my text edit is black. Hold on. How do I change it? Let's see, what's white? Now I can open. Let's open Chrome. Open up a new tab. Let's go to Google. Anyway, so I don't know if you can see it very well. Let's go full screen on this. Alright, so I don't know if you can see it, but there's some light blue color spots around here. Now, I'm not sure what causes this. I've heard these have a delamination problem, these displays. But as you can see, the color is not even. Just trying to, let's see. You can see the color isn't that even on this on the background. Now, it's not that noticeable. I've sort of gotten used to it, but I noticed it not long after. It didn't happen when I first got it. This is actually a not recent thing. It happened about 6 months after I got the computer. This blue sort of color shifting. Oh, not color shift, but like these blue patchy spots. It hasn't really gotten any worse, but it's possible that it could. Now, I'm not sure what's the cause of that. If it's, I think it might be related to that delamination problem, but yeah, I don't know how well you can see it on camera, but it's there. It's like a bluish tinge around where my cursor is, like around, like there's a blue spot around about here-ish. So yeah, that's the screen. But other than that, this display is really good. I like it. Now we move on to something I don't like as much, the keyboard. So this keyboard is the infamous butterfly keyboard with the touch bar. So, well, which one do I want to start off with first? Let's start with the keyboard because, I mean, to be honest, the touch bar shits me more, but the keyboard, I mean, to be honest, it's not horrible. I mean, it is horrible, but it's not the worst. Now, when the butterflies first came out with that little 12-inch, I hated them. I really didn't like the feel. These ones aren't as bad. I don't mind the clickiness, like the low travel. I don't mind that. I can actually go really fast on these. In fact, the only problem with typing on the keyboard here when I actually am typing fast is sometimes the palm rejection doesn't work on the trackpad and will fuck up what I'm typing. But other than that, the low travel doesn't bother me as much. Now, the problem with these keyboards are the reliability. Now, you've heard of the infamous you've heard of the infamous butterfly problems. So, the problems that these keyboards have are either the keys will get stuck and not register, or they will, like, double register. So, this one does not... This one is fine, and this keyboard is the original. Now, the way you can tell the original keyboards is by the function, the command and option keys, or the control, command, and option keys. So, if a 2016 keyboard has been replaced, Apple replaced them with the 2017 keyboards. And the 2017 keyboards have the different symbols on the control and option keys. Instead of, yeah, they have the little symbols on the control and option keys instead of, the 2016s don't. This is the original keyboard. I've never gotten this replaced. This thing has never seen an Apple store. Well, maybe it has, but this thing has never been to an Apple store under when I've had it, so it's been fine. It's all original. Keyboard still surprisingly works. It hasn't given me any trouble yet. I am expecting it to fail any minute, to be honest. It hasn't failed me, and I'm surprised because what causes the problem is dust and debris will get stuck in between these keycaps and either cause them to, double press or not register at all. I'm surprised this hasn't happened, especially where I live, because I live in a very dusty environment. My house, to be honest, isn't, dust just is horrible in this place. It's mostly because I live, and this house, especially for the last 6 years, it's in a new estate, and there's always been a lot of construction going on around here, and, I mean, yeah, it always has been, and, my place is very dusty, it always has been, and I don't clean it very often. Yes, I'm disgusting, I'm horrible. I mean, you can see my PS4 there has dust on it. I don't even want to show you my computer, it's just, no. Surprised this hasn't failed yet, because a lot of time I just keep the lid open, dust probably falls straight into the fucking keyboard, but it's fine. I haven't had any issues. And, like, it's not my primary computer. I don't type essays out in this thing, but I have typed a fair bit out on this thing. I actually wrote up a few cover letters on this thing when applying for jobs. But yeah, that's the keyboard. Like I said, the low travel or the butterfly doesn't shit me as much. Now, I would like a bit more travel. I mean, that would be ideal, but I can be nice and quick on this keyboard. The noise was also a problem. Apparently, it's very loud, which they are, and that's not me bashing a keyboard either. These are loud keys. I don't mind that. I mean, I use mechanical keyboards. And I even have a Model M, which is under a pile of shit. But, you know, I love loud keyboards. This doesn't sound good for being loud, but I don't mind it. I don't hate it. It's not a problem. Like I said, the loudness isn't an issue, the low travel isn't an issue, but I'm scared about the reliability. I don't know when it's going to fail. I don't want to get it prematurely replaced. I don't really feel the need to get it replaced. I kind of want to keep this machine as original as possible if I can. I mean, I don't really want to have to take it for repairs and have to fucking fix it and shit. But yeah, I can deal with it. Now, what shits me more about this computer is actually the fucking touch bar. So this was the flagship feature of these computers, apart from the USB-C ports, was the touch bar. So what the touch bar is on a normal laptop, you would have function keys up here, F1, escape, and F1 through F12, maybe like a home and delete, stuff like that. On these MacBooks, they replaced it with a little touch strip. So, as you can see, mine's currently showing the function keys, which would be there. Or, I mean, not the F1 keys, but like the brightness, mission control, the keyboard brightness, music playback, and the volume. Now, this is what's called. This is not the default configuration. This is actually, I've customized this because I hate the default configuration of the touch bar. It is honestly fucking useless. This thing is pointless. I hate it. I wish they made a 15-inch with real function keys. Now, they brought back the escape key on the new one, the one with the new keyboard, they still have the touch bar, though. I wish they just had normal function keys. I don't like the default configuration. Now, in fact, I'll show you what a default config is. If I just go to System Preferences. Yeah, I know. I have pending updates. I don't really care right now. If we go into, I think it's under Keyboard. That is not keyboard. Here. So you can see the touch bar here. We have, so the touch bar shows expanded control strip, and pressing the function key shows show app control. So by default, these are the other way around. So by default, it will, when you, the touch bar will just show the app controls. And by default, when you press function, it will give you the expanded control strip. Now, at least I think that's the way it was. I've had it set up for like this for so long that I don't even remember anymore. So, by default, it will show you this. And this is dependent on the app. This is contextual, actually. So, I don't have to hold down the function keys. I'm going to swap it over. There we go. So, let me quit System Preferences. So, now we're in Finder. right? You can see Finder up there. So this is the way the Touch Bar is by default. You have the app controls. Now for Finder, you have your back, forward, I guess that's a menu button, a few other buttons. And then you have what is over here called the control strip. So the control strip, this is the way it works. You basically, to get, so you have, by default, you have your brightness, volume up, volume down, and Siri. Brightness, volume, mute, and the Siri button. And then if you press on the control strip, in the arrow, you get the full version. That's what I have mine set by default, just so I don't have to click that button. This shits me. I hate the default config, because if you just want to adjust the volume, what you have to do is you have to click and hold, and then drag this shit along. This is so stupid, and it just, I don't like this at all. And then you drag it up, it looks cool, and it's cool to show off to people, I guess, but I don't care about showing off to people. I want to get shit done. So this is stupid. And same with the brightness. If I just want to, like, you have to hold it down and wait for this to come up, wait for it to do its stupid little animation. Like, I know it's only a second at most, but it's just, why waste the second? You don't need to. And Siri, well, that's useless. Like, I don't even use Siri on my iPhone. I think it's pointless. So I don't need it on the Mac either. And this, like, these app controls change depending on the app. Like, let's see, I'll go to my Outlook, so my email. Here we are. Here's my email. Now you can see Outlook controls are different. So you can see I have the app controls for Microsoft Outlook. And so, I mean, yeah, I mean, I guess these kind of, I mean, it's convenient, but what's wrong with just clicking inside the ribbon? I mean, you have the controls on the screen already. Or let's go to Chrome again. Please, Chrome. There we are. So Chrome, by default, you have back, forward, refresh, your home button, the address bar, as well as you have favorites, whatever this is, new tab, and then you have the control strip there. So, oops, wrong way. So, what's wrong with clicking the buttons on the screen? Like, refresh, yeah, refresh is actually the one I use. So, by default, I have the expanded control strip. So, when I hold down function, it'll be like just pressing F5. So that's not a bad thing. When I press and hold, see, I like the app controls when they're under the function key. This is the way it's by default. So if you press function, you just get F1 through to F12. However, I like it the way I had it before, which was the expanded control strip by default. So I can just quickly mash the volume or mash the brightness if I want to just crank up the screen or crank down the volume or whatever. You know, just mash it down or whatever. That's quick. It's easy. And then if I need to actually get to the app controls, just hold down function and you get to them. That's nice. I don't mind that. I don't like this default shit where it's like my control strip, I have to expand it and then get the mission control. And there we are. Even though I even use mission control, you can do that from the trackpad anyway. It's just silly, the touch bar. It's just silly. I'm not the biggest fan of it. I wish that I just had normal function keys. And I am going to go back to my old layout because this is really shitting me, to be honest. So I'm going to go expand a control strip. And then for the function key, you can actually choose to have different things. So you can actually have a few other things as well. So what you can have the app controls, expand a control strip, the F1 through F12 keys, quick actions, which I'm not sure what it is, as well as spaces. So if you choose spaces, this is honestly pointless because you can just use the trackpad for it. And the trackpad's more efficient and better anyway. You can just choose your spaces on the screen. Now, I have three spaces. I have my social media, my email, and my main desktop, which usually has a browser. And then maybe some others if I'm doing some other shit. I don't need to have the entire touch bar wasted with my spaces. When in fact, you can just swipe with the trackpad. Like, when you just swipe with three fingers on the trackpad, it's quicker and easier. So that one's pointless too. So I'm going to go back to expand the control strip, which I don't mind, and the function key row. And then function keys can go show app controls. There we go. Quit. That's the way I like it. If I want to just mash down the brightness, there we go. Done. Or you can hold the button as well. There we are. So I just want to mash down the brightness. I don't have to fucking hold it down and slide. All I have to do is just hold down, put my brightness up. There we go. This also has auto brightness as well, which honestly, Apple is the only one that can get auto brightness right. Every other auto brightness fucking sucks, in my opinion. Apple is the only one that seems to be able to do it right. But same with my volume. If I just want to mash the volume down, there we go. I quickly mute it, there we are. And this, by default, it actually has a Siri button here. Now, I actually removed it because I didn't like it. I actually have like having my Do Not Disturb there. So what we can do, we can actually... So you can customize what is on the touch bar. So if you go keyboard, and then you can go customize touch bar. So, yeah, I go customize. And so what it brings up this UI. Now, this is the weirdest shit, the weirdest way to control it. So what you do is you use the mouse, the trackpad. So this is what's, this is the default layout there. See, it's got the Siri button at the end. If I want to add something, let's say I want to add Siri back, right? What you do is you grab and you drag Siri back using the mouse off the edge of the screen into the touch bar. And there we are. Now it's added another button for Siri. And what you can do, see my mouse is at the bottom of the screen there. So if you want to move the button around, say I want Siri at the end next to the Touch ID, which we'll get to just in a minute. You actually have to go and grab Siri with the mouse and then drag it over like this. Instead of just touching it, you have to use the mouse to do it. It's really strange. And then you can just click OK and then it's done. Yeah, so that is the Touch Bar. So you can customize what is on it, which is nice. But the default configuration is stupid. And for the type of user I am, I mean, I rarely ever use the app controls. Honestly, the only time I actually ever use it is in Chrome, just to refresh the fucking page if I don't want to move my mouse to the refresh button. Instead of just pressing, on a normal computer, just press F5. But this, I mean, the refresh button in Chrome, where, on the touch bar is where F5 would be anyway. So that's why I just press function refresh. It's like pressing F5. It's fine. On some laptops, you have to press function to get to F5 anyway. So it's fine. That doesn't bother me because a lot of laptops you have to use function to do that sort of stuff. I just don't like the default config, how it shoves the little app controls in there. You have to expand it, drag the fucking... It's so stupid. I wish they just sold a version of this originally. They had a 13-inch with function keys. Why didn't they have a 15? Now, I don't have that 13-inch one anymore with the function keys, but they had a 15... They should have made a 15-inch with function keys. I reckon it probably would have sold pretty well. Even if it was base model, I reckon that they would have sold it. So that is the touch bar. Now, one thing that is on the touch bar that is nice, though... I mean, technically it's separate from the touch bar... is this. This is Touch ID. With a jizz flake on it. Now, this is the Touch ID sensor. So, this... it's a fingerprint reader. So you've had Touch ID on iPhones since the 5S. This was the first Macintosh to have Touch ID. Now Touch ID is nice, I like it, but it's not perfect. It only works in Mac OS. It does not work in Windows, which is a shame. But if you don't run Windows on the thing, then I guess it won't matter to you. But I do have Windows on here because I'm a Windows user, and I do run some Windows programs on here. Especially since my desktop's not running, I'm going to need to edit this video, and my video editing software runs on Windows. Even though I do have Final Cut installed, but I don't like Final Cut, so I just had it there to try it, and I haven't touched it since. But yes, Touch ID is really nice. Now, it integrates with a lot of the macOS stuff, so if I lock the computer here, and just let it go to sleep here, just wait for it to go to sleep. There we go. So the computer is basically sleep mode. I can just touch the sensor and it wakes up. It's pretty quick. You don't have to swipe. You just touch it. There you go. You're in. Not all Macs have Touch ID, and the Mac OS doesn't really give you many options for passwords if you just want to quickly log in. Windows does give you more. You can actually have a PIN code instead of your password. You can have, of course, you have to have a full password, but in Windows 10 and Windows 8 as well, I think. You could actually use different options for passwords. Of course, in Windows 10, you have the Hello stuff. So if you have Windows Hello Camera, Windows Hello Fingerprint, you could also just use a PIN code. Instead of typing your full password, you could just type a little PIN code on the number pad, which is what I do on this computer. macOS doesn't have any of that. But so on a MacBook or any other Mac without Touch ID, and this is all a desktop Mac, so don't even have any kind of authentication, then yeah, you have to type in your full password, and I don't like doing that. So that's why I'm glad Touch ID exists. Now, there is an option to use an Apple Watch, which I have one. Yes, I have one. This is the first time I've ever talked about it, actually. But yes, if you do have an Apple Watch, it does authenticate on its own. So you can use the Apple Watch to authenticate on a Mac if you don't have Touch ID. But Touch ID is nice. They should build it into the desktop keyboard and build it into every Mac they can. I think they have it on the Air now as well. But yes, Touch ID is nice. If you use Safari, it actually stores passwords in Safari as well. It actually integrates with the iCloud keychain. So if you with the iCloud keychain, if you have your you actually have a bunch of stored passwords on both iOS and macOS, they all integrate into the same system through iCloud. Touch ID, and what they can do, they can either use Touch ID or Face ID if you have one of the newer devices like the iPhone 10 or whatnot, which I do. But yes, Touch ID is nice. I do like it. That's the only redeeming thing about the Touch Bar, to be honest, is Touch ID. Now we come to the reason why I fell in love with this laptop. That is the trackpad. Oh my god, the trackpad. I absolutely adore this trackpad. The keyboard and touch bar fucking shit me. The screen, yeah, it's nice, but you can get nice screens on PCs as well. You can get thin and light PCs. You can get PCs with Thunderbolt 3. You can't get a PC with a trackpad this nice. I'm saying that right now. They don't exist. Yes, Microsoft have the precision trackpads on the Surface, and some other manufacturers like Dell use them. My sister's laptop has an XPS 15 9550, which is about the same age as this thing. Has a nice trackpad on it for a Windows laptop. This is on a different level. It just is. The only other trackpad that's just as good as this is the desktop version that goes with the iMac, like the desktop standalone trackpad. Which is this, but in a standalone form factor. If I used macOS on my desktop, I would buy the standalone trackpad just to have it. I totally would. macOS is so nice with the trackpad. They've just made the gestures really well. Now, I'm fanboying over the trackpad, but it's just good. Like, it's just really nice. It's so fluid. You don't even think about it. With my old laptops, PCs, I'd always plug in a mouse. So my ThinkPads, I had the track point and a trackpad, but unless if I had no space to put a mouse, I mean, that's the only times I would use them. If I was on a desk, I'd always plug in a mouse to my T420 or my Surface Pro or any of the previous laptops I've had. This computer, I don't, except in Windows. I use a mouse in Windows, but under macOS, I don't. This trackpad just works so well. It's so smooth. It's a glass trackpad, and it's one of the Force Touch trackpads. So it's pressure sensitive. So when I click it, you can hear it clicking, right? That's not a real click. It feels like a real click. It feels like the trackpad's moving. It's not. So this uses the taptic engine, which is also used in the iPhones, well, at least until the iPhone 11 anyway. But this uses a taptic engine, and it simulates a click. And the reason why this is so good is because the old ones used like a mechanism where the hinge was at the top, and then they'd click. When you click down, it would click, like click, 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 like that. And so it would click really easy from the bottom, but it would be really difficult to click from the top. The Force Touch trackpad fixes this, so it clicks evenly everywhere. You can click right at the top here, and it's really even, and it's the same click no matter where you are on the trackpad. It's just really nice. Now, the other benefit of this is that there's no moving parts, so there's less stuff to go wrong. I mean, it is more complicated to probably replace if it does go wrong, but you also don't have to, you can also use the pressure sensitivity to force click. So this is a normal click, and this is a force click. I don't know if you can hear that on camera, but so there's like a secondary click. So you click once, put more pressure down, and it gives you a force click. So I'll show you with the drive icon here. So you can see when I click it, normally it just selects it, right? If I force click it, that didn't do anything, sorry. If I force click the drive icon, it opens up Quick Look. Now, I guess you can do the same if you just press space with a selected thing. But this means you don't have to lift your hand off the mouse. So there we are. So you just open that up. If I can do it on this, there we go. On another one of these files down here, this folder, there we go. That's just the desktop. If I open up Chrome, Right, and I just type in, I don't know, like, Jews. Right. So just looking up Jews. If I want to go to, like, I can just force click on a link, and this opens up a quick look as well. So this will give me a definition for the word. This will bring up a thesaurus as well for any other matching words. And it will tell me other stuff here. It may even give me a preview of the web page. Safari does more with this than Chrome does. If you click a link in here, it will actually open in Safari because Apple integration and whatnot. If you have an image on the desktop, it will give you a preview of that image. It's just nice. Now, you don't use the force click very often. I really don't. I mean, the only times I use it is when I'm in the dock. So, as you can see, I've been opening the same Chrome window for a while. And I keep minimizing it, but I actually have two of them open. So, in order to get to my second Chrome window, I can either right click and then select which one, which is the peasant way, or if I want to, get to my other Chrome windows, I force click on Chrome, and there we are. There's my two Chrome windows. One while I'm watching Daddy Doug DeMiro, and the other one with the Jews. All right? So there we go. We'll just minimize both of those again. There we are. So there we are. So you can just force click on the dock icon. If I force click on Steam here, there we are. There's Steam. If I force click on Outlook, there's my Outlook. So this trackpad is absolutely nice. It's huge too. It's nice and big. I've got giant man hands, and so I love how there's just enough space. There's plenty of space. The gestures in macOS are just so smooth and silky. So if I want to switch spaces, like I was mentioning earlier with the touch bar, when you switch spaces, you just do it through the desktop with the trackpad. Just swipe with three fingers. It's like an iPad. It's like a touchscreen. It's like a tablet. You just see, even in Outlook, what I can do, if I want to delete a message, I scroll with two fingers and delete it as if I was on a phone, just swiping it out. So the Windows version of Outlook doesn't have this. That's nice. With the Mac, you don't have to lift your hand off the mouse or off the trackpad to do things. I mean, it's they kind of engineer it in a way where on a PC, they've built it around keyboard-centric navigation. Windows is built around keyboard navigation because that's where its roots are. Windows's roots are in, MS-DOS, Windows 3.1, where people didn't have mice, or Windows 95, where, I mean, people had mice, but a lot of the UI is still keyboard-centric navigation. So in a Windows PC, I navigate with the keyboard all the time. I don't like taking my hands off the keyboard. The Mac's the opposite. The Mac is engineered to never take your hand off the mouse, especially these trackpads. Unless you need to type something, the Mac, it's nice to just not have to move your hand off the mouse to Alt Tab. Yes, you can Alt Tab or Command Tab in this case, but if I wanted to get to that's why I have things in spaces. In Windows, I never use the virtual desktops. I use them on a laptop, but not really. I never use them that much. On this thing, I have them open all the time, just because it's so convenient. If I want to go to Outlook, there we go. If I want to go back to Discord, there we go. So it's just nice. It's just nice. Kind of like a 69. It's just nice. But that's a trackpad. Now I'm gonna stop fanboying over the trackpad. You've probably already fucking if you're still watching a video, thank you. I appreciate that. And you're probably sick of hearing me talk about it, but it's why I like this computer. It's why I kept it. It's why I didn't just sell it off and make a profit. Honestly, it is. That, as well as how thin and light it is for a 15-inch computer. Now, like I said earlier in the video, I was looking for something smaller. But, to be honest, I've come to really like how thin and light this computer is. Now, it's not a lightweight, but it weighs a lot less than my T420. It's got a bigger screen. Much more power, and it's much thinner. It's like a giant ultrabook. It just is. I really like it. That's why I kind of like this computer. The trackpad just makes it so much nicer to use as a laptop. I don't have to find a desk to plug in a mouse just so I get a decent experience. I hated using the trackpad on my ThinkPad, and the track point, I know how to use one, of course, but it's not the most ideal. So I better show you the specs, I suppose, because I actually haven't really delved into the specs that much. So I told you what I had in the beginning. We are running macOS Catalina. Now, we're not running the latest version of it, 10.15.1. There's been a software update for the last week or so on this computer. I haven't bothered to update it because I've just been really busy with life at the moment. But probably, I've even got a software update on my phone pending as well. Like, I'm starting to really not install updates right away anymore because I've just had some bad experiences. But yes, so we have macOS Catalina. It is a MacBook Pro 15-inch from 2016. Like I said, yeah, 2.7 GHz i7, that's a 6820HQ, with 16 gigs of DDR3. Right now, because we're running battery power, we are on the Intel HD630. If we go system report here, we can open up the system profiler. There we are. This will give us a bit more detail with what we have here. So the model designation is the MacBook Pro 13,3. It is, I think, the A1270 or something, I think is what this thing is. No, A1770 is what this chassis code is for the 2016, I think 2017 MacBooks. It is the A1770. I'll correct that in the video if I'm incorrect. See, what else do we have? So, let's see if I go down to graphics and displays. So right now we have the Intel HD 530 as well as the Radeon Pro 455. So let's click on the Radeon. So Intel integrated, you know what the HD 530 is. Let's look at the Radeon. So we can see, if I can focus, sorry. Bear with me. I couldn't be bothered getting my tripod out. Let me just lower the brightness here. So, Radeon Pro 455, it is 2 gigabytes of VRAM, PCI Express, of course. It is running on an X8 lane, so it is running on 8 lanes. I'm surprised, actually, not 16, for an integrated, for a soldered-on GPU. It is metal-supported, so of course it runs the newest versions of macOS. I mean, it better bloody run the newest versions of macOS. So this thing, like I said, High Sierra is when I got it. So originally when it was new, it came with Sierra 10.12. I got it with High Sierra, because I got it, you know, High Sierra was the newest when this came out. Mojave was on its way out when this thing was new. When I got this, actually. So I got it with High Sierra. I didn't like High Sierra much, to be honest. It felt kind of buggy and weird. But then I upgraded to Mojave, and Mojave was honestly, like, just one of the best OSs I've probably ever used. It felt so stable and nice. Now, I'm running Catalina. Catalina doesn't feel as polished as Mojave did. And a lot of 32-bit apps don't run, which is some games I have. I mean, yes, I actually do have some Mac-compatible games. I wanted to have City Skylines on this thing. I had it on here. It actually ran pretty well. But then I installed Catalina, and now that doesn't work. Because it's 32-bit. It's a 32-bit game. So now I can't have City Skylines on my laptop anymore. So unless I should just install it under Windows, I suppose. But I liked having it under Mac OS, so I didn't have to reboot all the time. Now if I go down to, where's my cursor? If I go down to memory, here we are. So you can see the way the RAM's set up, even though it's soldered on, it is still acting like it is two slots on here. So we have, two, so it's, the system sees it as 2 8-gigabyte DIMMs of LPDDR3 at 2133 megahertz. It is soldered onto the motherboard, though. It is I guess, set up in a configuration of, being 2 DIMMs. Now let's see, NVMe Express. There's the SSD. It is coming up as an Apple SSD. So we can see capacity is 512 gigs. So, yep, 500 gigs. Trim support, of course. So, let's see, do we have, like... So, it says link speed is 8... I'm not sure what that measurement is, sorry. Because I'm a pleb. Not sure what the speed of the thing is. So, I have two partitions on here. I have a Windows partition, and I think macOS splits itself into two different partitions. When macOS is obviously an APFS, I actually had this as HFS Plus for a while, until Catalina forced me to go to APFS. That kind of broke some stuff in Windows as well, Because Windows, the switch, little switch wrap to go back to Mac OS, doesn't work now that it's APFS. It did before when I was using HFS Plus. But since I went to APFS, that stopped working. So, yeah. It forced me to go to APFS with Catalina. But I was running HFS Plus before that. Either Catalina or Mojave, I don't remember. I know I was doing it in High Sierra. I think Mojave was also HFS, but I could be wrong. Let's see, what else do we have? So, Thunderbolt USB. And so, what Wi-Fi chip do we have in here? Oh, it's not going to pull up anything. Oh, yes it is. Never mind. So, what Wi-Fi chip do we have? So, I'm curious. So, there's an Airport Extreme. It'd be some Apple stuff, I think. Broadcom. Yeah, Apple always use Broadcom. So there we go. That is the specs of the MacBook. I do have Windows installed. Like I said, you can see there's my Windows drive right there. Now, I could boot into Windows. In fact, I do need to actually to put this video on it because I need to edit this video. This is the only computer I've got, and I use Sony Vegas. So, well, just Vegas Pro now, actually. So, yes, let's go ahead, and I'm going to reboot into Windows. So let's do that right now. I'm just going to leave my shit open. It'll be fine. And there we are. And let's see how quick it boots into Windows. So to go into Windows, we need to hold down the Option key. There we are. So I'm just going to hold down the Option key. There we are. And there's the two drives. So we just select the Windows drive, and so you can see it has an arrow there, which means it's going to boot into Windows, but as soon as we reboot, it'll go back to Mac OS, because Mac OS is the default. If we want to make Windows the default, we hold down Control, and see, now you can see it turns into a different arrow, which means it will reboot, which means that if we restart, it will go into Windows by default. So we don't want to go into Windows by default now, though. We just want to go in there and have a look. So this is in real time. I'm not going to cut anything out of this boot here. And this is Windows 10 version 1909. So latest version of Windows 10. There we go. So there we are. Let me just log in. There we are. There is Windows 10. So now, in Windows, this thing is not the greatest Windows computer. Everyone says, oh, Macs are the best Windows computers. They're not. Yeah, maybe fucking 10 years ago, that might have been true, because Vista wasn't the greatest, but I liked Vista, actually. But yeah, Macs aren't the greatest Windows computers, especially the newer ones. The trackpad, oh my god. So you know how I praise a trackpad in Mac OS? This thing fucking sucks in Windows. It is so horrible in Windows. And that's because Apple's drivers are fucking dog shit. So there's a third-party trackpad utility I actually installed called Trackpad++, which sort of emulates the functionality of Mac OS. It gives the trackpad gesture support. So like you can see here, I'm actually the same gesture assigned as in Mac OS to bring up Action Center. So there we are, the Notification Center in Mac OS also uses that gesture. I've also got the three finger, I think it's four fingers in Windows, actually, to bring up Task View. There we are. It doesn't work as well in Windows, to be honest. Four finger gestures kind of suck, but I should probably change that to a three. But yeah, as you can see, here is Windows. So Windows is Windows. So let's see. Now I'm more familiar with Windows, of course. So if I just right click, come on, right click, properties, device manager. See, I haven't put the OEM info in there. But yes, you can see, I'm used to, see, in Windows as well, the command key acts as your Windows key, and it's in the wrong spot. You can see we have Control Windows Alt. We have Control Alt Windows, so it's back. These are backwards. Now, you can use utilities to swap that over, but when I'm in Windows, I actually sort of, I get used to it. I don't mind it. But you can see in Windows here, same specs, of course. I mean, i7-6820HQ, 2.7 GHz with 16 gigs of RAM. Here's Device Manager. All the normal shit you would have in Device Manager. We're not going to go through it again. We saw everything that we needed to. So See, if I go system devices, this will tell me what chipset we have. So we have the Intel 100 series chipset because it's Skylake. What else do we have in here? Of course, processors. It's a quad-core hyperthread. So it has eight logical processors. So if I go to displays, now Windows only uses the AMD card. So Windows does not use the integrated graphics, even if you're on battery power. Windows will use the AMD card regardless. The switching doesn't work in Windows, I've noticed. It doesn't use the Intel. So Windows, your battery life will probably be worse. Battery life has actually been really good on this. For a 15-inch laptop, I get like about 5 hours out of it, which is more than I did my T420, which was a smaller computer. But then again, this thing's more power efficient because it's, you know, newer generation stuff rather than Sandy Bridge. But yeah, there's Windows 10. I mean, it's Windows is Windows. Like, there's nothing else to really show on here. Like, I do have my video editor on here, Vegas Pro. Does it not work? What? Oh, you gotta be shitting me. Is it broken? Vegas. Oh, I may have to reinstall Vegas then. Fucking hell. Alright, well, see, Windows just breaks shit. This worked fine as far as I knew, but I guess not after the 1909 update. That's what broke the fucking keyboard on this thing, was 1909. It worked for a couple weeks and then it stopped. Right, enough of my rant about Windows. I'm guessing I'm sounding like an Apple faggot, but, you know, trust me, I'm not. Still PCMR. But yeah, there's Windows. So that, I mean, I do have some games installed now. I do have GTA 5. I haven't actually played it, to be honest. I don't really know what it runs like. But Windows is on here just in case I need it. There are some Windows programs I use, like my video editing software, as well as, you know, stuff like, you know, some parts of Microsoft Office. Like, for example, if I need Microsoft Access, you know, for database shit, which I don't really use these days, but I did when I was in TAFE, and Access is not available on Mac OS. So, there we are, Microsoft fucking Access, or Microsoft Publisher, or some other Windows program that I like, that I don't really want to find, or I can't find an equivalent on Mac OS, or the Mac OS equivalent fucking sucks. You know, Windows is here when I need it, especially for mostly my video editing software, you know, Vegas Pro. I don't like Vegas. I'm starting to kind of hate it, but it's what I know, it's what I use, and it's what I'm comfortable with. So that's why I continue to use it, even though I kind of think it sucks. So let's reboot into the Mac OS. Let's just do this in real time. My camera's flashing at me for either low storage or low battery. Not sure which one, I can't read it. So if I hold down the Option key, and let's hold down Control. It's not Option. So I hold down Control and, just to do some finger gymnastics. Sorry, but I had to put the camera down there. So let me put my password in. So, like I said, this thing is lightning quick. I mean, the boot ups and shutdown put my fucking desktop to shame. Although, hopefully with that 970 Evo I showed earlier, that will change, so. There we are. So there, that is the MacBook Pro. So this is my laptop. This is what I've been using for the last 18 months, or thereabouts, roughly, about a year and a half. I like this thing a lot. Maybe I'm turning into an Apple faggot, right? I guess I've got my iPhone, which I've had for nearly 2 years. I've got this MacBook. I have an Apple Watch, which I got in October of last year. Yes, I didn't show this thing, but I've had an Apple Watch Series 4 for a fucking while now. Yeah, maybe I am turning into a Mac fag, but to be honest, I just use what suits me the best. And so I love Windows on a desktop. This works. Well, when it did work. Apart from fucking keyboard not working. But I feel like Mac OS, at least for me, is better on a for a laptop. This works. It's not the laptop I wanted, but it's the one I've come to like. And I don't care about your childish bullshit opinion, because, I mean, I just use what I like, and, you know, I just use what I like, and I'm happy with it. If I'm not happy with something, I don't use it. But if I'm happy with something, I stick with it. It's why I stick with Vegas, even though I'm kind of not happy with it, but that's what I know. To be honest, I really like this computer. It's been really nice for me. I mean, it does have some problems, actually. The wireless in it is not the greatest, to be honest. It actually gives me some trouble with Wi-Fi sometimes. At least it did under Mojave. It hasn't done it so much under Catalina. But look, I just use what I like, and I don't bother with this fanboy shit. I have a Windows PC, I have a Mac, have an Xbox, I have a PlayStation, I have an iPhone, I've got an Android and a drawer. My old phone's Android. You know, I just use what I feel is the best for me at this point in time, and right now I feel like this is a nice computer. I like my phone, I like my watch, I like everything I've got. I'm just into tech, man, and if people can't handle something that's different than what I would normally have, because I'm generally the Windows guy, I mean, well, sometimes stuff changes. And yeah, I'm still the Windows guy. I still keep up with that mostly. But, you know, it's always good to have, you know, a foot in either side. So, just to see, because I just like tech. I just like to keep up with what's happening with tech. And, I mean, if that means going over to the dark side of the demon Apple, then so be it. So there we are. That's the video on my new laptop. I'm probably going to cause some controversy in the comments, but I don't give a fuck. So thank you for watching this video. Next video, like I showed you, is going to be on this, an upgrade for my desktop over here, this Samsung 970 Evo SSD, because I need to reinstall Windows anyway, and so we're going to put this in. So there we are. Thank you very much for watching, and I hope you have a good one. Take care.